Hello. On behalf of the Cal Poly Humboldt Department of Dance, Music, and Theater, welcome to Fulkerson Recital Hall. In order to best protect the health of everyone, concert patrons are encouraged to remain masked at all times while inside the music building. And now, please take a moment to ensure that all phones and other electronic devices are silenced. Also, there is no recording, flash photography, food, or drink permitted in the recital hall. If you should need to exit during the performance, please allow an usher to escort you out during the applause between musical selections. Thank you, and enjoy the performance.
Thank you. All right. Welcome, everybody. My name is Paul Cummings. I'm the director of our wind ensemble, and this is our Cal Poly Humboldt Wind Ensemble. Thank you. So that was an oft-played march, March of the Belgian Paratroopers, Pierre Le Mans. You might say it took two world wars to get that piece written because some paratroopers from Belgium actually approached him at the end of World War I with a request to write a march. And he started it but didn't finish it. And then it just sat in a closet somewhere anonymously, you might say. And then World War II came along and another group of paratroopers approached him and asked if he would complete that march. And he finally went back to it, took up the same melodic material that he had started with the first time, and finished it. It's really a delightful piece, and isn't it interesting how the piccolos and bass clarinets work together there at the beginning and at the end? We're gonna proceed now with a piece called Satyric Dances. This is music by Norman Della Gioia from the 1970s. It was commissioned by the town of Concord, Massachusetts, where the city fathers wanted to commemorate the bicentennial of 1775. Of course, Concord was the center of much activity among our founding fathers and the whole revolutionary period in our history. And the city fathers approached Della Gioia about writing music that would depict some of that energy that was associated with the 1775 spirit. It's called Satyric Dances for a comedy by Aristophanes. So the Greek playwright, Aristophanes, wrote several comedies in which satire was a prominent element. And I think you're gonna be able to pick up on that satire in this music. It's sort of got an evil clown quality or a Phantom of the Opera quality in it, music written in 1975, Norman Della Gioia.
Thank you.
that's a little too spooky. Okay. Starting to regret saying anything about evil clowns there. So I should also mention that's one movement of satiric dances. There are two more movements, and we're going to perform all three for our next concert in December. You're all invited back. We're going to go ahead now with music by a composer who's been called the Dean of American Composers, Aaron Copland, a composer of many, many ballets, Rodeo, Billy the Kid. Copland is kind of universal in our culture. And this is music from a film score that he wrote. He was not only active in writing for the stage, for ballet troupes, but also for Hollywood. And this is an example of one of his film scores. The original material is from a novella by John Steinbeck. And Steinbeck's story of the Red Pony features three or four characters, and they really are characters with unique personalities. So one of them is Jody. The story is kind of centered around Jody, who's a 10-year-old boy growing up on a rural California ranch. And Jody's grandfather is one of the characters. And then a cowhand on the ranch named Billy Buck. And then Jody's parents, the Tiflins. So Copland's imagination was struck by Steinbeck's story. And the music features little character studies of each one of those figures. And so you'll recognize some childlike music here, which represents the 10-year-old Jody. And another feature of this music, especially if you're interested in the academic side of music, music theory, Copland uses a lot of bitonality here, so two different keys happening at the same time, which you may wonder how that can work, but he does it so frequently in this piece that we sort of get used to it after a while. And it might represent, we don't know exactly, Copland didn't write a lot about this music, but it might represent the contrasting characters of the 10-year-old boy Jody with the parents or with Billy Buck the cowhand. And you know, they've got the real adult work to do on the ranch while Jody can just play around like a 10-year-old kid is supposed to do. So I'll give you a quick example of bitonality.
So let's do a B flat scale, concert B flat in half notes, and just one half note per scale degree, concert B flat. Yeah? One, two, and zero.
Century composers who were just growing tired of the kind of standard traditional use of tonality where everybody's playing in the same key all the time and we start in that key and then we might wander a little bit but we always come back to that home key. So just a little warning here for that harmonic element to the music. It's very different.
Thank you.
Did you hear some of that crazy harmony?
A little bit.
Crunchy. It's fun for us to play music like that. It's not always pretty. Not always got to be perfectly harmonious. There's a lot of substance in that music by Copland. We're going to move on now to a much more reflective kind of piece. This is by a living American composer who's getting a lot of attention throughout the country by major orchestras, lots of wind bands like ours, because he's good. He's quite a craftsman, has a real gift for melody. This piece is a little bit different in his output because, as I say, it's much more reflective, and it's the second movement of a symphony that he wrote, and he calls it a Wine Dark Sea Symphony for Band because it's based on the Odyssey story by Homer. And so I'll read a little bit from the program notes for this work, which the composer wrote. Whenever we can hear from the composer himself, it's always more meaningful. The full symphony tells the story of Odysseus and his journey home following his victory in the Trojan War. But Odysseus' journey would take as long as the war itself. Homer called the ocean on which Odysseus sailed a wine-dark sea. And for the Greek king, it was as murky and disorienting as its name. He would not find his way across it without first losing himself. The Cruel Moon, the title of this piece, is the song of the beautiful and immortal nymph Calypso, who finds Odysseus near death, washed up on the shore of the island where she lives all alone. So there's been a shipwreck with Odysseus and his men as they are leaving Troy and heading toward Rome. Calypso nurses Odysseus back to health and sings as she moves back and forth with a golden shuttle at her loom. Odysseus shares her bed 7 years past. The tapestry she began when she nursed him becomes a record of their love. But one day, Odysseus remembers his home. He tells Calypso he needs to leave her to return to his wife and son. Typical guy, right? He scoffs at all she has given him. Calypso is heartbroken. And yet that night, Calypso again paces at her loom. She unravels her tapestry and weaves it into a sail for Odysseus. In the morning, she shows Odysseus a raft equipped with the sail she has made and stocked with bread and wine, and calls up a gentle and steady wind to carry him home. Goddess that she is, she can conjure anything she wants. Shattered, Calypso watches him go. He does not look back. I mentioned the harmony in Copland. This composer is even more adventurous with lots of extended chords. So we don't just have major triads going on. We have seventh chords, ninth chords, and 11th chords for you music theory enthusiasts or guitar players, perhaps. So we hope you enjoy John Mackey's This Cruel Moon.
Thank you.
You might have noticed we have musicians moving around between pieces. That's because we trade off parts that are divided within each section. So for example, there's first trumpet, second trumpet, third trumpet. So we rotate so nobody gets stuck playing low notes all the time, basically. So to conclude our program, we're going to play an exciting piece by a Vietnamese composer, Viet Quang. I'll say a few words about that in a minute. But just to let you know, Jazz Orchestra is coming up, second half of the program. We hope you're going to hang around for that. They always have a great set. And we always have a pretty lengthy intermission, 20 minutes, to get our stage reset for that. So you have plenty of time to relax after Wind Ensemble finishes. And just a few words about our group. Let's see. Would you stand up if you are a student? And let's see, thank you, have a seat. And stand up if you are a music major student. And I think all the percussionists want you to know that they're already standing. And then we also want to recognize our community members. Would everybody stand up in the community? So we have a nice mixture of students and community music majors, non-majors. It's one big happy family. And we also have faculty, so would you stand up? There he is. Yes, Fred Tempest, our wonderful tuba player and tuba faculty here. So, I want to say a few words about this next piece. Again, there are program notes. Oh dear, did I forget somebody? We have two fantastic high school students from Arcata High School. Would you guys stand up, please? Thank you. Yes, I was in big trouble if I didn't remember those two. Okay, so to conclude our program, a piece called Diamond Tide. You know, we're in a stage in the arts, not just music, but all the arts, where we're trying to get away from everything being composed or written or created by dead white European males. And so here's an example of that. He's not dead, he's not white, and he's not European. He is a male, but we're making progress. Viet Quang is a real phenom in the music world, in the compositional world. His music is being performed all over the world. A really great craftsman. Born in 1990, just a kid, and you'll hear what an excellent composer he is in this piece. Again, like Copland, he's provided some program notes about this piece, Diamond Tide, and they're really interesting program notes, so I'll read that to you quickly. A 2010 article published in Nature details an experiment in which scientists were able to successfully melt a diamond. And for the first time, they were able to measure the temperature and the pressure necessary to melt it. When diamonds are heated to very high temperatures, they don't melt. They simply turn into graphite, which then melts. And the thought of liquid graphite isn't nearly as appealing or beautiful as liquid diamond. Therefore, the addition of extremely high pressure 40 million times the pressure we feel on Earth at sea level is crucial to melt a diamond. The extreme temperature and pressure used in this experiment are found on Neptune and Uranus, and scientists therefore believe that seas of liquid diamond are possible on those two planets. Oceans of diamond may also account for these planets' peculiar magnetic and geographic poles, which do not line up like they do here on Earth. Lastly, as the scientists were melting the diamonds, they saw floating shards of solid diamond forming in the pools, sort of like icebergs in our oceans. So imagine this: distant planets with oceans of liquid diamond filled with bergs of sparkling solid diamonds drifting in the tide. These theories are somewhat conjecture, but this alluring imagery provided heaps of inspiration for Diamond Tide, which utilizes the melting sounds of metallic water percussion and trombone glissandos throughout. Two movements, Diamond Tide by Viet Quang.
Thank you. very much. See, we heard from lots of folks on that. Matthias Severn on tenor saxophone. Greg Quast on the trombone. Riley McKella on alto saxophone. The entire trumpet section. Andrew Henderson, Chris Cox, Kevin Blake, Eddie Callan. And Ricardo Paredes on tenor saxophone. Next tune that we're going to play for you, April in Paris, was arranged for the Count Basie Orchestra back in the 1950s by the organist Wild Bill Davis. This is an absolutely iconic recording. It's in the Grammy Hall of Fame. We are going to interpret that recording. If you know the recording, you will definitely recognize a lot of this arrangement. There's a couple of very iconic things about that recording, which I think you will hear in our performance as well. This is April in Paris. One more time. Let's try it one more once.
Thank you. That was George Emerson on the trombone. Andrew Henderson on the trumpet solo. Yeah, on the original Count Basie recording of that chart, the trumpet solo was played by Thad Jones with that famous Pop Goes the Weasel quote in there, which Andrew then quoted before going off and doing his own thing. Our next chart is arranged by this very same Thad Jones. After he left Count Basie's band, he started his own group with the drummer Mel Lewis called, imaginatively enough, the Thad Jones Mel Lewis Orchestra. And he arranged the old standard, All of Me, for that band. We're going to do that right now.
One, two.
Thank you. That was John Gerving on the piano. Rebecca Lopez on soprano saxophone. And George Epperson on the trombone. Back in the early days of the pandemic, when we were all at home a lot, I got into this thing where I would look at the clock at exactly 11:11, like many times a week. Like, I did the math. 11:11 comes up on your clock 14 times a week. Okay? I was seeing it like 9-10 times a week, easy. Okay? It was starting to freak me out a little bit. And it became kind of a running joke in my family. Like, oh, it's 11:11. And finally, my lovely wife says to me, why don't you just write a tune called 11:11? So I did. If you're going to write a tune called 11:11, it really has to be in the meter of 11. And it pretty much has to be an 11-bar blues.
Thank you.
Solos on that by Brian White on the trombone. Jeff Ruiz on trumpets. Nick DeAnda on guitar. And Eddie Callan on the trumpets. And on drums, that was Travis Strong. So an air shaft is the space that is required by law to exist between big apartment buildings in New York City. You know, they try to cram everything as close as possible together there because real estate's really expensive. They try to fit as many people as they can into as small a space as possible. So they pass this law that says you have to have a minimum amount of space between the buildings so people can actually like have windows that'll open and things like that. Duke Ellington wrote this piece called Harlem Airshaft that is all about the sights and sounds and smells that one picks up if you're living in one of those apartment buildings in Harlem. And imagine the summer day when everyone's got their windows open because it's nice and hot outside. And so you're picking up all these sounds from all over the place, everybody's open windows, and cooking smells are coming in, and so on. And so this is his depiction of that. This is Harlem Airshaft.
Thank you.
Thank you. You heard from Brian White on the trombone. Andrew Henderson on the trumpets. And Ricardo Paredes on tenor saxophone. The entire Cal Poly Humboldt Jazz Orchestra. Stand up, everybody. Thank you all very much. Thanks for coming out. Have a great night.